Without further ado, I would love to introduce our final panel and invite the panelists to come on stage for the art of historical fiction. Jeet Thayil will be our moderator, and I'd like to welcome Linda Grant, Lawrence Norfolk and Madeline Miller to the stage. And unfortunately, Philip Hensher, as you may already know, is unwell and in London, so we send our best wishes to him, but he won't be here with us today. So thank you so much to everybody, and please give them a very, very warm welcome as they make their way to the stage.
Hello and welcome to, I think, probably one of the last couple of panels for this festival, for this edition of the Jaipur Literature Festival. We are talking today to three writers who specialize in the historical novel. And I'm going to introduce them by reading their official biographies and then a little couple of lines, couple of additional lines. Linda Grant is a winner of the Orange Prize for Fiction for her novel When I Lived in Modern Times, and she was shortlisted for the Booker Prize for The Clothes on Their Backs. Her grandparents, that's the official bio, her grandparents are from Russia and Poland, and she belongs, she says, to a completely immigrant culture where Yiddish was spoken at home to conceal from the children what was really going on. She writes about the transmission of the past from one generation to the other and the faultiness of that transmission. Linda Grant, ladies and gentlemen.
Okay. Oh, I start? Okay. I have to say I don't actually really specialize in the historical novel. I have written one set in 1946, which was not that far before I was born. But the novels that I write are really about, nobody in my family ever did anything important or was part of history. They were just kind of the churning mass of humanity that history kicked around. So I have no great interest in the doings of great men. But what I am interested in is the way the past is transmitted from one generation to another. And the way I think it's true of all immigrant cultures, your parents and grandparents lie to you. This novel, The Clothes on Their Backs, the one that was shortlisted for the Booker, is about a young woman who discovers that she has an evil uncle. He is a slum landlord and a pimp, but he was also a survivor of the Holocaust, which is a very contradictory thing. And she goes and takes down his memoir, his autobiography. So this is just a very short passage. It was at our next session that my uncle told me something which would make a deep impression on me. He said that it was his observation while a slave laborer that people can bear much more than animals. A horse, for example, its ribs still covered in flesh, suddenly drops down dead in the middle of the road, while an emaciated man in rags keeps going, struggles on long after his internal organs have been irreparably damaged by starvation. Only the ones who lose their minds are quick to go under. But if you can keep your sanity, then you are capable of extraordinary feats of endurance. It was also of great interest to him to note that in many cases, an individual was exactly the same at the end as he had been at the beginning. Beneath it all, he argued, people are concerned with the same things all their lives. Sex, food, power, ideas, if that's their interest. A sourpuss stayed a sourpuss, of course, but there were some whose optimism, humour, their pleasure in fun, and their indestructible love of life remained intact all the way. What about you, I asked. Yes, I was one of the ones who didn't change. I began as a businessman, and that is how I continued.
Thank you. Expands your idea of historical fiction. Our next panelist is Lawrence Norfolk, and he lives in Chiswick, West London. His wife is from India. though she was born in Britain, and he says she's more English than he is. Lawrence has always, he says, tried to write contemporary literature, but failed. And in that process lies a tale that he will tell, and he will also tell us about how he became a novelist, turned up at the London Book Fair with an A4 sheet of paper to find an agent, and I'll let him tell that story. Ladies and gentlemen, Lawrence Norfolk.
Thank you, thank you. Thanks for being here at the end. I mean, do you want me to read as well?
I think so.
Okay, yeah. I'm going to read. Yeah. I will read a short, very short passage from my current novel, which is called John Satinel's Feast. It looks like this, and it sounds like this. This passage is set in the 17th century, and the book is set in England, and it tells the story of an orphan who becomes the greatest cook of his age, but he falls in love with the wrong girl. But it's a two-but novel, not a one-but novel. But the English Civil War happens and destroys his world. The passage I'm going to read, the Civil War hasn't happened. Charles I still has his head, and John has just entered the kitchen. A wave of noise broke over John, voices shouting, pots banging, pans clanging, knives and cleavers thudding on blocks. But John hardly heard the din. A great flood of aromas swamped the noise, thick as soup and foaming with flavors, powdery sugars and crystallized fruit, dank slabs of beef and boiling cabbage, sweating onions and steaming beets. Fronts of fresh baked bread rolled forward, then sweeter cakes. Behind, the whiffs of roasting capons and braising bacon came the great smoke-blackened hams which hung in the hearth. Fish was poaching somewhere in a savory liquor, at once sweet and tart, its aromas braided in swirling spirals. A moment later it was lost in the tangle of scents that rose from the other pots, pans, and great steaming urns. The rich stew of smells and tastes reached into his memory to haul up dishes and platters. For a moment he was back in the wood. His mother's voice was reciting the dishes, and the spiced wine was settling like a balm in his stomach, banishing his cold, banishing his hunger, his anger. He closed his eyes and breathed in the scents, drawing them deeper and deeper. And there you have it, English cuisine in one paragraph. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Excellent, thank you.
Thank you.
And finally, we have Madeline Miller, who is a teacher, and her first novel took as a subject something as remote from contemporary America as it may be possible to get, and that is a homosexual love affair set in Homeric Greece, in which almost everybody dies. She is also a winner of the Orange Prize. Ladies and gentlemen, Madeline Miller.
I had a session earlier today where I read some different passages, but I thought it's always good to start at the beginning, so I'm just going to read the very beginning of the novel. It's a retelling of the myths around the Greek hero Achilles from the perspective of his closest companion and lover, Patroclus. And Patroclus has, he's born a prince, but other than that, he has pretty much the most inauspicious beginning possible. My father was a king and the son of kings. He was a short man, as most of us were, and built like a bull, all shoulders. He married my mother when she was 14 and sworn by the priestess to be fruitful. It was a good match. She was an only child, and her father's fortune would go to her husband. He did not find out until the wedding that she was simple. Her father had been scrupulous about keeping her veiled until the ceremony, and my father had humored him. If she were ugly, there were always slave girls and serving boys. When at last they pulled off the veil, they say my mother smiled. That is how they knew she was quite stupid. Brides did not smile. When I was delivered, a boy, he plucked me from her arms and handed me to a nurse. In pity, the midwife gave my mother a pillow to hold instead of me. My mother hugged it. She did not seem to notice a change had been made. Quickly, I became a disappointment. Small, slight. I was not fast. I was not strong. I could not sing. The best that could be said of me was that I was not sickly. The colds and cramps that seized my peers left me untouched. This only made my father suspicious. Was I a changeling, inhuman? He scowled at me, watching. My hand shook, feeling his gaze. And there was my mother, dribbling wine on herself.
Interesting thing to me about all three passages is that they sound to me more like fiction than historical fiction. So the question is, why write historical fiction rather than fiction when it's clear that any one of you could write fiction?
I admire your confidence.
Your excerpt certainly sounded and looked to me like fiction.
No, the food was too good. I think, I mean, should I pick, do you want me to pick that ball up and run with it? Okay.
Yeah.
I'm going to start by trying to explain what a historical novelist is. And I'm going to ask for your help. I see a couple of worried faces in the audience. Don't worry, I'm not going to ask you to sing or anything like that. But I want you to hang on to this because it's going to have a few twists and turns in this explanation. To explain what a historical novelist is, I first have to explain John Keats's definition of what a poet was. John Keats, the Romantic poet. John Keats wrote in a letter to Fanny Brown, and he said, the least poetical thing imaginable is a poet. And what he meant by that was that he could be a bird, or he could be an animal, or he could be a Grecian urn, or autumn, or he could be any of the things that he was describing. And when he was trying to be those things, he couldn't be a poet at the same time. You can't be looking in on yourself doing what you're doing. You have to just do it. And the same applies to being a historical novelist. So in my career as a historical novelist, I've not been a historical novelist. I've been a fish underneath the Baltic Sea. That was in my second novel. I've been a rat in the Vatican. And most recently, I've been a cook in 17th century England. But I haven't been a novelist in any of those books. And I certainly haven't been a historical novelist. Now, this much is obvious. You have to go back to be what's there. You can't look back. You can't look back over 400 years and present it as if it's that far away. You have to go there and be there. Now, that's what you know. So you know to be a rat. You know to be the fish. You know to be a cook. Then it gets more complicated. Stop me if this is getting too much. Okay, you're still with me. No singing yet. The difficult thing is what you don't know. As a historical novelist, you have to not know a lot of things. Now, in order to explain this, I'm going to have to tell you the history of England. Now, again, you are looking at it. Luckily, the history of England only has three events in it. The first of it, you know at least one. The first event is that King William the Conqueror beat Harold at Hastings in 1066. That's the first one. The second one is that we, the English, believe it or not, cut off the head of Charles I in 1648. That's the second event. And the third event, which you do all know, happened this year in 2013, which is, you're looking blank again. The third event was that England beat India in a test series on the subcontinent. Those are the three events in English history. But I'm going to concern myself, you'll be pleased to know, not with the third event, but the second event, the cutting off of King Charles I's head, which happens in the middle of my novel. So as I was writing the novel, King Charles I appears, and I, Lawrence Norfolk, the person, know very well that he's going to lose his head. But I, Lawrence Norfolk, the historical novelist, I have no idea that that's going to happen. If I do know it's going to happen, then the scene is ruined. All my characters know something they can't possibly know. So I have to not know that. So the historical novel is not historical. When you're back there 400 years ago, or hurling a Greek lance down 3,000 years, or launching a ballistic missile in the 1940s, as Linda does, when you're launching, or as I do, throwing a soup ladle across the kitchen or whatever, when I'm back there 400 years ago, that's not the past. That's today. That's my today as a historical novelist. It's just that it happened a long time ago. So that's my definition of being a historical novelist. I'm sorry it was so convoluted. You hung on well.
Madeline.
I think that's a beautiful way of describing some of the something that's really can be a challenge about writing something that's set in the past is the fact that you do kind of have to forget stuff that came after it and really commit to that historical moment. You can't always be kind of winking slyly at the future. Actually, I sort of consider, I also kind of look at historical fiction not just as something that authors self-identify, you know, I am a historical novelist, but also as something that I think has been, is a label that sometimes people use just to put on a novel, oh, this is set in the past, therefore historical fiction. And I think that sometimes that can be useful, you know, it's a, you have to shelve the book somehow. But I think that also I really love to see books crossing borders. I think that sometimes in the past that's actually been a little bit of an insult. You were saying that, you know, his novel reads as fiction, as literary fiction. Right. But I think that both those genres should be respected. And I think that in the past, historically, historical fiction has not necessarily been as respected. But when you have practitioners like Lawrence, like Linda, obviously it should be given equal respect. So for me, I see historical novel as a novel written that it happens to take place in the past. But, you know, there isn't some special magical potion trick that you drop into it and it suddenly transforms into historical fiction. You're still using all the things that you need for a good, you know, regular fiction novel. In terms of my own book, I actually don't really see it as historical fiction for the main reason that there are gods in it. So there are heroes, there are mythological happenings, there's a centaur. So I really sort of think of it more like something called mythological fiction, which doesn't really exist, but I made it up. Because it isn't quite trying to get back to a specific historical moment and summon that. It's trying to get back to a poetic moment and a mythological moment. So I kind of like to break down the boundaries between all of these all these genres, you know, mythology, history, literary novels, all of that.
Question for Linda. Is it when you write about history without being a historian, could it be that it's less sexy? Or it's sexier, actually, to write historical fiction rather than to be a historian? And would that expand readership as well?
Well, you know, I should say I only write about the recent past and the past which is in living memory. And because it's in living memory, I mean, this novel is set in 1977, which is going to be history for some of the people sitting here. It's going to be before you're born. Do we think of that as history? I mean, if it's before your own lifetime, then of course it's history. I mean, history is last week. History is being written all the time. I think the issue becomes when people, if it is in living memory, people will come up to you and say, it didn't happen like that, by which they mean, it didn't happen to me like that. Or it could be the official record doesn't say that, the official record says something else. But I'm trying to write about the experiences of ordinary people who are not making history, but are being kind of pushed around by it. And I think that the question of any kind of fiction is, can you get inside the head of a person who is not yourself? And you have to ask this question of, you know, I was always being asked about every novel I wrote, whatever time period it was set in, is it autobiographical? Because I think there's sort of people want fiction and want books to be true. And so I would always say, yes, it is about my experiences as a pimp in Budapest before the war. you know, I've drawn very heavily on that and my experiences as slum landlord in London in the 1950s. And I remember one book, a woman coming up to me and saying, you know, quite an irate manner, a very elderly woman about one novel, and saying, you know, she said, I want to know where you got this story about this and where you got this. When did that happen to you? And I said, it didn't happen to me. I made it up. And she looked at me and she suddenly, and this is about 10 years ago, she suddenly said, you're too young. And I said, yes, I am. This is all before I was born. None of this happened, you know. I made it all up. And, you know, everything I write is made up. I mean, you might throw in a few dates to kind of provide a kind of skeleton. But, you know, the difference between history and fiction is if you're an historian, you are not permitted to make it up. And if you're a fiction writer, if you don't escape from the facts, if you don't get away from them and produce something which is purely an act of your imagination, then it's just dead on the page.
Is there also a kind of a resistance to autobiography in that you don't want to put yourself into the story?
Well, I mean, just briefly on that, I mean, every novel that I've written is autobiographical, but not in the sense of this happened to me.
Right.
I had this conversation, I went here, I did this, but in the sense of these are the things which concern me psychically, emotionally, these are the themes which engage me, which I'm constantly, I mean, it's a well-known saying that every writer writes the same book. And of course, that's absolutely true. You're always writing the same book. And you're always, my novels are all about displacement, about feeling that you don't belong, about going, leaving home to make a journey. They're all coming home after making a journey. People who feel themselves to be not part of British life because wasn't brought up to feel British and take no responsibility for the empire, by the way. All happened before my grandparents got here. So people want novels to be autobiographical because they think that they're more authentic. But then if they are autobiographical, they think, well, it's not really fiction, is it? So you're sort of slightly caught between two stools, I think. And you might be safer in historical fiction because nobody could tell you that it's autobiographical.
Well, let's open that up. Madeline Lawrence, is it a resistance to putting... the true I into.
Yeah, when I began writing my first novel in, I think it was 1702, and at that time there was a genre of novel which was very very common called the Hampstead novel. I sincerely hope you don't know what that is because it was a terrible thing. It always had the same hero. It was a young man. He'd come to London for the first time, and he didn't know what to do with himself, but he found himself through writing. And at the end of this novel, you could see him through usually a darkly lit window, sitting in front of his typewriter, typing the novel which you had just read. And if I knew only one thing about writing fiction, and that was I did not want to write that book. So I thought I was safe. I would write about a dictionary writer in the 18th century who uncovers a conspiracy to do with the East India Company. In a nutshell, the book's 600 pages long. You don't want any more detail than that. And I thought that this would be fine. So I wrote the book, and it came out. And I said this, you know, I said I wanted a story that was not me, that was not autobiographical. And then one interviewer said, "Well, where did you grow up?" And I said, "Oh, I grew up in the country." And they said, "Yes, like your hero." I said, "Yes, that's true. He did grow up in the country." And then he said, "What did you do next?" I said, "Well, I went to London." And he said, "Well, didn't he go to London?" And I said, "Yeah, well, yes, he did." And then they said, "What does he do in the novel?" And I said, "Well, it's called Lompriere's Dictionary. He writes the dictionary." And then they said, "Well, you just said that you made money while you were a student writing dictionary entries." And I said, "Well, yes, I did." And so it went on. And there were all these autobiographical coincidences, which it was like your own life had like reared up like a net to sort of pull you down beneath the surface again into autobiography. So I think Linda's right. In a way, you do keep writing about yourself, even if you're determined not to. But at the same time, I acknowledge that for your work to be good, it has to mean something to you. You have to care about it. So it has to have some relationship to you. It has to have some relationship to your life, what you do, what you think, and what you feel. So to a degree, it must be autobiographical. Otherwise, it would be a very cold thing, I think. So I think that, yeah.
Madeline.
I agree. I think you both said that beautifully. I mean, when you are writing a novel, you know, or when a novel is produced, there's always a writer who's on the other end of the pen or the other end of the keyboard, you know, and it's their personality, their experiences, their obsessions that are informing this novel. And you know, you don't want to take that away. Then suddenly you have a computer writing a book. So, of course, you know, who the author is informing what comes out.
The great historical novelist William Burroughs, I'm joking, said, but he did say this, he said, history is fiction. Is the distinction between fiction and nonfiction essentially false?
Well, I mean, I think that one of the interesting things is how many people are now consuming or arriving at history through fiction. I'm sure most people here are well aware of the huge blockbuster series by, well, two novels by Hilary Mantel, which has won the Booker in succession. Wolf Hall and what's the second one? Doesn't matter.
Can't remember.
Yeah, but it's about Thomas Cromwell, a figure who is barely known in, you know, amongst the general public, a very significant figure in Tudor history, but not one that I think anybody on, you know, you tap them on the street, anybody other than a historian could tell you who they're about. And what seems to have happened is that the general public has, you know, dived into this kind of very, very deep well or pool of Tudor history, and has discovered that this is the way that they want to understand, you know, the distant past. And perhaps there may be a, you know, rejection of, you know, of history books in favor of the fictionalization of it. Because there always is this question, which is that people, somebody who lived 500 years ago, were they really like us? And that is one of the most extraordinary questions of all. In what sense were they like us? And were they at all? You know, we're all human beings, but to what extent has our notion of what being human is been transformed over the centuries? And I think that fiction is the way that people are coming now to read history. Sorry for the historian in the audience I see sitting on the front row. Right.
Lawrence. There is no such thing as non-fiction. it's an entire chimera. The notion that, I mean, where do you stand to tell the story that is non-fiction? Wherever you are, you're somewhere, you're someone, it's your view. Even when official statistics are collated, they're collated in a particular way. When someone says that as the East Germans used to say, that I think it was 3,573 suicides in 1970 something in the East German Republic. There weren't exactly that number. That's not true. That's someone's view. Even a statistic as bald as that, it won't be exactly accurate. It'll be one or two out. There is no such thing as nonfiction. And as the historical facts march their way through. From the supposedly primary sources through the secondary and the third sources, they seem to gain a momentum, a kind of appearance of truth, and this is entirely unmerited. If you really want to know the truth about something, then go to art. I wouldn't say the historical novel particularly, I mean art in general. At the bedrock of art is the idea that someone can see something clearly, that you clear away the normality, that what people say is normality, the normal way of viewing things, and you see it afresh and new, and above all, clearly. Only art does that, because only art isn't being paid by someone else to tell you something else. So I don't think there is such a thing as non-fiction. It's not a shtick, I actually think that.
Thanks.
Well, I certainly think that that those boundaries are getting more and more blurry. And I think you're right to talk about the fact that just as, you know, there's always an author on the other end of the keyboard, that still holds true for nonfiction, and people bring their own biases to history, their own perspective, the things they're interested in. And I think that sometimes we talk about nonfiction and we sort of seem to mean objective truth, and that those are not really the same thing. And it's been interesting to watch the emergence of this new category called creative nonfiction, where you have books like The Devil in the White City, conversations that are being kind of reconstructed but basically made up, but it still is nonfiction. So I think that it's been interesting to see how those categories are shifting and people are kind of recognizing that, you know, maybe all nonfiction is creative nonfiction.
I just want, in terms of what Lawrence said, that, you know, that art takes you closer to reality than fiction, I mean, I want to agree with him wholeheartedly, but I don't agree with him 100%. And the reason I think that is that I think that there is one event, one historical event, which happened in Europe in the 1940s, which was the Holocaust, which has been fictionalized many, many times. And I've never found anything as satisfactory in the fiction as I have in the nonfiction, even, you know, even sort of quite simply written memoir. But when you take somebody like Primo Levi, for example, his account, I think it is greater than any fiction.
I'd like to, we're going to open this up for questions in a minute, but just before we do that, could we talk a little bit about the craft of historical fiction and something about research and how you come up with the ideas for the books that you write?
Okay. Well, when I wrote this novel, When I Lived in Modern Times, which is set in 1 year in Tel Aviv in the 1940s, and people said, you must have done a lot of research. And what I actually did was I went to the Colindale newspaper library, and I got back issues of a newspaper called the Palestine Post. And I didn't actually read the stories on the front page. I looked at the classified ads at the back, and they were much more interesting in telling you something about the period. The, you know, what kind of shops there were and where they were located. And then I read the crime stories. I read sort of little stories about murders. And people said, you must have done a lot of research. And I said, I realized that if I do a lot of research, then what's going to happen is the research will block out all the things which are in my head, which are imaginative, and I don't want to have very much research at all. And if I wanted to know something, I just went and looked it up when I wanted to know it. There are writers who, and I've met them, who don't write a word until they've done all their research, and they've mapped out chapter by chapter by chapter, you know, the synopsis of what everything is going to happen. I mean, frankly, for me personally, I would be so bored by that stage that I would just stop writing the book. I'm also quite lazy as well, so research is not high on my list. That's what you do.
No,
right, well, there you are. Which just goes to show that, you know, you must never listen to any writer telling you what's the right way of doing something.
Do you map it all out, Madeline?
Well, I think there's always, for me anyway, there's kind of a dance towards the research and then away, and then towards and then away. I'm specifically thinking now about a particular section that I think I probably did something like 40 drafts of. And this isn't quite the same as research, because I was basing, this novel is inspired by Homer's Iliad. So when I finally catch up to the Iliad in here, the Iliad starts in the last year of the Trojan War, and this book starts at, you know, basically the beginning of Achilles and Patroclus' lives. But when I finally get to the first scene of the Iliad, it's this big blowout fight between Achilles and Agamemnon. And it was a scene that I knew quite well in the Greek. I had studied it in a number of different classes. I basically sort of had parts committed to memory. And it was incredibly hard to do my version of it, because there was Homer kind of blaring in my head, and I sort of couldn't find my way through the scene. So I found that actually I had to really consciously kind of shove Homer aside to find my own voice in the scene. But then there were other times as I was writing the book where I would find that that I would get really stuck creatively. And so then I would go to Homer and I would read it, and it would sort of jog something loose, and then I would be inspired again and I would sort of find a solution to the problem. So that really characterized my whole process with research, is sort of stepping towards, stepping away.
A kind of a dance.
Yeah.
Lawrence.
Yeah, two points to make from that. The first is that I could research forever. I mean, it's just, you sit in the library and you read I was reading 17th century cookbooks for this book, the best one was called The Closet of Sir Kenelm Digby Opened, and it starts off with 108, count them, 108 recipes for a honey-based drink called metheglin, which is not drunk anyway, and then it gets onto pies and things like that afterwards. So it's a deeply eccentric work. And I remember reading that and thinking, I'm not getting anything out of this. I don't need another recipe for metheglin. Then I turned the page and we got to breakfast. And he said, here's the perfect way to poach an egg. He didn't put it quite like that. Boil water until the surface shivers. And then drop your egg gently into the water for the exact time it takes to say an Ave Maria slowly. And the whole of the 17th century shifted just a little bit at that point. I thought, yes, they didn't have thermometers, but they could watch the surface of the water shiver, not boil. And they didn't have timers, but they said an Ave Maria every day. It was exactly that time. So it can be an absolute joy. And then on the other hand, then I got to, so that, you know, that was fun. And then the other thing to say is that it's also a seduction. It's endless. You know, you look at this a fact like that, and you thought, and there's a footnote to another book, and you think, I'll just get that book out. I'll just have a look at that one. And so you go on through the whole library. You can spend your whole day in there. I think Donna Tartt once said, this is about composition, not research, but this is how I feel about it. She said, I'm the kind of person who can happily spend the whole day pushing a semicolon around the page.
Well, that's why her books take 10 years to write.
Yeah. Yeah.
Anyway. So we're going to open this up now. Yes?
Good questions.
I was actually going to the back to try to give the back.
Oh, all right. No, go ahead. No, that's fine.
Is that okay?
Yes.
All right. Thank you. I have just completed a novel covering 1775 to 1810. It covers the history of slaves in African countries going to different British colonies. So my question to you is, what do you think presenting history to in fiction to characters, can they appeal more to the young generation? Because normally the tendency for the young generation to go more for ITs, etc. So do you think it helps for them to read the novel and learn the history at the same time?
I'll do a very quick answer to that, which is that you've only just left the young generation. I'm in the middle generation, but I'm looking around at this audience, and the young generation is mostly what I'm seeing. So I think the answer to your question is that they are. That would be my answer. I just take the survey of what I'm seeing now and what I know of my own readership.
Could we keep the questions very brief, because many people want to ask questions?
Yeah. This is Rama Pandey. Happened to be Lawrence's aunt also.
She's my auntie, yeah, everyone. My auntie.
Yeah. I have seen why I'm taking first, you must clap. This is the first son-in-law has come into my son to this thing. I have been a witness, being an author and filmmaker, to Lawrence writing this book. It has taken me two books in 5 years, and it has taken 10 years of Lawrence's life to write this book. The recipe he's talking about, we were all witness to that. All day long with two little kids, he would keep on going. And then one day we went to the Richmond House, which is an historical place, where they keep the British cuisine and British kitchen of that time intact. And the recipes are there for you to research and go through that. And so we thought we would help him out. His mother-in-law, we all took the notes and we went to him. And he says, look here, what we found for you about this. And there he was sitting. You're talking about this. Well, I saw this 2 years ago. And that's what is the process. So what I'm saying, you did mention, Linda mentioned, so did Madeline, that the research is part of historical novel. And for a young generation, the images you leave is very important for them. That is the drama, the era they have not seen. So when you think of the drama you're talking about, is that what you write, the drama, and you take the liberty with it, do you also keep in mind that even if you're not a historian, what you are writing could very much be part of their present as history?
Very good. I think that's a question about the nature of historical research and what gets left over. And should I do it very quickly? I'm sorry to monopolize. I'll just say a very short anecdote about Akira Kurosawa, the Japanese filmmaker. I was in New York, and I was talking to the City Lights bookstore owner, and we were talking about historical research, and he said, how much of what you research actually goes into the novel? And I'm sure that this is true for my fellow panelists. And I said, the answer is, alas, not much. You know, you research 100%, and maybe one in 100 things goes out, and you spend a lot of time raking this stuff out. And he said, Kurosawa. And I said, what? And he said, well, Kurosawa used to break plates and crockery and throw them into the fields behind the shot when he was shooting his films. He knew that no one would see them, but they subtly changed the way the film looked. And I think the research you don't use, it's kind of like that. It's not in the book, but it somehow changes the book. It makes the book heavier. I don't know. Do you find that?
Yes.
But I think that's true about fiction generally,
that you often know far more about the characters that you're telling the readers. You write something and it doesn't kind of quite fit, but at least you know that about the character. It may be something, it's like an iceberg. The reader is only seeing the tip of it, and you have a whole depth of reality underneath, which I think the reader often senses. That, you know, sometimes there are hints and clues or something. You don't have to tell the reader absolutely everything. It just isn't necessary. What you have to do is to create an impression which is made up of all kinds of fragments of different things, some of which are that which has not been said.
Yeah, and I think it's the same thing with theater. That, you know, if an actor is going to be portraying a character, they may only be portraying kind of a very small segment, but they need to understand the whole backstory. Mm-hmm. Even if, you know, the audience doesn't see it, they do see it in the depth of the performance.
I think we have a question up here.
Yeah, sir, you mentioned the concept about when you're writing a historical novel, it's more important about not knowing about what you're going to write about. It's more important to get into the head of the character.
Yeah. So,
and with regards to historical novels, you can write two kinds of historical novels. One is just which is simply based in the past, and one which is centered around an important historical event or an important historical figure. And as Linda pointed out, that for certain historical events, something like the Holocaust, she found that a non-fiction work was the most satisfying work. So my question is, when you decide for example, to write about an important historical event or important historical character, do you feel a sense of moral responsibility to stay true to the facts and be accurate? Or the moment you decide that you're writing a historical fiction, you shun the responsibility to be true to the character, just like, for example, maybe what Dan Brown did in The Da Vinci Code?
Yeah, yeah. Thank you for offering me that way out, yeah. I think Philippa Gregory, who's a historical novelist, once said, she was reading a historical novel and she said, "I was fine until the drain pipes." And I said, "What do you mean, Philippa? Come on." And she said, "I was reading this historical novel set in the 16th century and she said it started raining and the rain went down the drain pipe." And I said, "What's wrong with that?" She said, "Drain pipes weren't invented until the 18th century." That kind of accuracy is, I think you have to get those things right. I mean, it's because they only have a negative value. They're the sorts of things which if you don't get them right, it's gone wrong. They don't give you anything. And then there's the truth to the events which you're writing about, which when you give them their due weight and their gravitas, why was the Civil War important? I mean, you can get all the facts right, the dates of the Battle of Naseby, or, you know, why was the Trojan War important? Why were the 1940s important in Britain? You can get all the facts right, but really they're important because those events impacted on people. And if you can't show those, the way that those events mold people's emotional responses and mold their relationships and change how the story has to be told, if they're not changing it by necessity, then the event itself is lessened. It was like, well, I don't care that they were at war. They were all having a great time anyway. You know, if you're in the middle of a war, people have to be having a bad time, and you have to care about those people having a bad time. Otherwise, the war doesn't mean the same thing. So you have to be true to the big events like that, I think, through the prism of your characters.
I mean, it's often been said about Jane Austen that she's writing these novels at a time when huge political events are taking place, and nobody is talking about them, nobody's discussing them, there's no mention of them, they don't impact very much on the characters' lives, other than when people go off to war, the soldiers and the sailors. So when Jane Austen was writing, she wasn't writing about her contemporary history. She was writing about the lives of contemporary people who lived in the moment that she was living. And there's a tendency, I think, you know, often when I watch TV in particular, anything which is to do with the Second World War will always begin with the family gathered around the wireless, waiting to hear the news, Neville Chamberlain's announcement, you know, we have not been able to make peace with Germany. And, you know, this is this kind of slot-in thing which happens in every film about the war. And then, you know, you get the parallel bookend, which is victory dancing. But I'm sure there were people who, during that famous announcement, were on the toilet, having a bath, having sex, you know, gone for a walk, have forgotten about it. And I think those are the sort of, you know, the people I'm kind of more interested in, the people that You know, the people that history has completely overlooked and forgotten about, who didn't feel that they were part of history at the time. They got kind of swept up in it, but they were not really there, you know, standing at attention, waiting for these momentous events to take place.
Yeah. I think we have a question up there.
Up the back?
Yeah.
I think there's a lady on the left, and then
okay.
Go here.
All right, sure.
Not a lady, but anyway. The question I have is that, given that so much of our sort of our subconscious and our conscious, which we imbibe from school, ideas of rationality, the products of the Enlightenment and the Industrial Revolution, how do you edit out that when you're writing a historical character? Do you ever fear that you're just picking up the modern mind and throwing it into the fourth century? How do you recreate the conscious of someone who doesn't have the intellectual tools that we take so for granted we may not realize we have, David Hume and Henry Ford?
I think one thing is to read as many primary sources as possible, because then you're going right into the mindset of people who are from that time. So I would absolutely say go to the primary sources. And you know, do your best. But I was interested in the drainpipe story that you told, because Homer, who is, we could possibly consider a sort of, you know, proto-historical novelist, would absolutely fail that test.
The Iliad is
full of anachronisms. It's full of things that, you know, are completely ahistorical for the moment. So it's also interesting to see how historical fiction has changed, and that was totally fine. That was accepted and welcomed. So I think that there's something also about the modern world that, with all the greater access, you know, Homer didn't have access to a modern research library, and that with that comes, I think, a greater pressure for that exacting kind of rigor that you were talking about.
Hello. My question is a variation of the previous last question. That is, history being a recollection of events as told by the author of the victor side. So how does that change the onus on you as a historical novelist or a historical fiction novelist as to the actual reconstruction of the actual novel? Like the Iliad, for example, is an oral tradition. How does the Iliad's version, that's Homer's Iliad, how does that change with the actual Iliad, and how do you address with that?
Well, I mean, I think that the Iliad is, you know, as you say, it was composed orally, and so it really is kind of a different tradition. And I think that because of that, you have to also, I mean, again, I would sort of say that I don't really, my work is really a literary adaptation, is really what it is. And so I think that when you're doing a literary adaptation, you're always trying to engage in some way, even if to totally overturn or subvert, you're trying to engage with the spirit of the original piece. And so that sort of becomes your foundation. Now, you can do this a totally different way, and there are a number of brilliant historical novels written about kind of Bronze Age Mycenaean Greece that attempts to get to what it was really like if you were really a prince of Troy at that time. But then there's this other path that says, I accept Homer with all of his drainpipes, and, you know, and I take that world, and that's my world, and I'm going to write from that place.
You mentioned a lot, and other questions have been asked, about the unlearning, the unbecoming, when you're concerning a character. But I was wondering, more than the consciousness of your character, how do you escape the fact that you may be responding to other novels perhaps written in that time? So, for example, if you're writing about 19th century England, how do you escape responding to something that was actually written in that time, like the you know, the classic Victorian novel? So it's, how do you escape your own consciousness?
What I described was a kind of creative forgetting, and that's perfection, and you never reach that. You never perfectly forget what's going to happen. You do know that, and of course you. This was, I think Hume was mentioned earlier. You think in a particular way, And that's hard to escape from as well. But I would refer back to what Madeline said, really. Although it sounds like alchemy, if you read the sources that exist, and the primary sources, I stress the primary sources, not the secondary sources, and oddly, there aren't that many. In any given period, if you want to read the primary sources, you can get through them. If you want to read the whole of Greek and Roman literature, it's a bookcase about that by that. That's it. There's not that much. And I read everything about 17th century cookery. It took me 3.5 weeks. The 1940s might take a little bit longer, but but it's surprising how few primary sources there are and how many secondary sources there are. The primary sources contain a voice and a mindset and also the lack of knowledge that you want. And that's the only way to get at it. And then by a process of kind of creative sympathy, you become those people if you can.
So can I just, wanted to address something which somebody asked a couple of questions ago. There's a kind of new genre of kind of quasi-historical fiction, which is taking fictional individuals, who would have been as rare as anything in their societies, like transsexuals, for example, or women who went to sea as pirates dressed as men. And there's a sense in which there's an historical novel which does transpose the contemporary mind into the past, or contemporary individuals into the past. And I wrote this novel about a young woman who was born in the sort of 1924, and she's not educated, which is kind of quite tricky for me to do. She's a clothes horse. She's a sales girl in a dress shop. And people said, why wasn't she feisty? Feisty is a very new word, which means, a feisty, go-getting woman. But actually, I felt that with her biography, she wouldn't be feisty. She wouldn't be a feminist. She would be somebody who would, be very reliant on men. And I think that the contemporary mind has actually a lot of trouble with the mind of the past, the women of the past, unless they were those great exceptions, the trailblazers, the pioneers. We're more interested in the pioneers and the sort of great mass of humanity who didn't think original thoughts or defy convention.
My question relates to what has been talked about earlier, about using imagination to go beyond history. And fictionalizing a known historical event. My question is, can we visualize an alternative course of history and keep make a novel based upon that setting? For instance, in the Indian context, can we have a novel based upon the setting in which the Indian partition does not take place and Jinnah becomes the head of the government? Or if, say, for instance, the East India Company doesn't come to India at all?
The question was about counterfactual history, historical novels in which something that did happen doesn't happen, or something that didn't happen does. I'll add one, Hitler winning World War II. There's been a couple of those. Okay. I'm not going to answer it. I was just restating it.
Sounded a bit like historical science fiction, actually. And yes, Linda.
Well, I mean, there is a genre, and it's called counterfactual historical fiction. Robert Harris did do this novel about America occupied by Germany in the 1960s, I think. I mean, it's occupied in the 1960s, not when the book was published. I mean, I find that kind of imaginatively very interesting, and I sort of wish there was more of it. I mean, you could say Dan Brown is counterfactual, since, when I tried to find out the truth of all this stuff, it turned out it was mostly rubbish.
So is the historical novelist Quentin Tarantino, the Inglorious Bastards. Hitler and his cohorts are all killed.
Yeah.
Yes, any more final questions?
This lady.
Well, forgive me for taking you back to where we started, but all novels are either based on the future or on the past. And when you're writing in the past, you can't actually skip over events that happened. So how do you actually differentiate between fiction, literary fiction, and historical fiction?
I am going back to the beginning, so I'll be brief. Which is that I don't believe in historical fiction when I'm doing it. And it's contemporary fiction, and I'm writing in my now. The now of the last book started in 1625 and ended in 1669, I think. That was my today, and that is today. You all think today is today, but you're all wrong. You're all wrong.
I don't think there is a distinction. I mean, there is historical fiction, which is badly written potboiler stuff, and then there's historical fiction, which is fantastically well written and full of ideas. That's literary fiction. It doesn't matter what the subject is. The subject is kind of irrelevant, really. You approach a novel and say, what's the truth of this novel? How is it written? What are the ideas in it? How are the characters presented? Do they feel real to me, or do they kind of, you know, smell of sort of some kind of unreality? What is the structure? Is anything interesting happening in the way this story is being told? That's the definition of literary fiction. It doesn't matter what its subject is.
I think we have time for just two more questions, depending on how brief they are.
I had one question about, you talked about adaptation, about how yours is a literary adaptation. Do you think historical fiction, sorry if I use the term, how does it differ from an adaptation, let's say in dance or drama or in song? Do you think you have more liberty or less liberty, and how?
Well, I think that it's different types of liberty. I mean, I think that if you're doing a, so the question, let me just make sure I understand, the question is that do you have more freedom when you're doing it in writing versus other types of, you know, creative endeavor? That's a really good question, and I don't dance and I don't sing, just like Patroclus. So I'm not sure, but I can say that in theater, I also direct plays, and directing plays and sort of writing novels feels very similar to me when you're adapting. And in fact, directing, for example, a classic play like a Shakespeare play sort of is an adaptation in and of itself. That as a director, really what you're doing when you're directing King Lear is you're adapting Shakespeare's King Lear. You're putting your ideas, you're casting the actors, you're making the choices. So I see a lot of similarities with theater, and sadly, I'm not gifted enough to speak to the other disciplines.
I think you have to adapt. It's you, the artist, who has to adapt. You have to become at one with your material. You have to be sympathetic to it and allow it to do what it wants to do to a degree. Not all the way. There is some input. I'm not saying all art is completely passive, but I think to stamp a kind of grid of novelness on experience is going to end up in a bad novel and bad experience. So that's what I think.
This is a question to Linda. Lawrence has been quite has explained quite well how much work goes into his work, but you've been close to dismissive about your work. And I'm talking of 1947, if you take 1947 and some of the books, talking about that time and the same issues, Palestine, Israel, the Holocaust, whether in Europe or Hungary or anything. Yeah. And I'm reading this book called The Lemon Tree. I'm not yet.
Oh, yes, I know it.
Sandy Tolan.
Yeah.
And it's nonfiction, it's a true account, and set as fiction, but brilliant. I mean, it's absolutely simple and amazing, and it strikes much more than the other discourses of grandeur. Mm-hmm. You know, a couple of books across that age. Mm-hmm. If you were to write on Palestine or to do something close to that, and say in the occupied land, and if it was, say, a short story on Palestine, how much research, how much would you put into it?
I wouldn't write anything about Palestine, and the reason I wouldn't do so is because whatever it was that I wrote, I would be told that I would be appropriating somebody else's voice. It's too politically loaded to do it. It would never feel to me as authentic as if it was written by a Palestinian woman or a Palestinian man. I always have to write about something that I know from the inside, not knowing from doing research. And you take a situation like that, which is politically explosive in every single way, including literature, I think that it is actually no longer possible to write from the point of view of the other. I don't think it's actually permitted to write from the point of view of the other without somebody attacking you and saying, why are you expropriating the voice of somebody else? So I would not do it.
We've actually just had a request from a young lady in the audience. You alluded to a story about a single piece of A4 paper that Lawrence took to a book fair, yes, but she said, yeah. Is there any chance we could just finish on that story, perhaps?
Could we have that?
Oh, okay. If you want to be a novelist, this is how to do it. This is how to not do it. This is how I started. Everyone's starting story is different. This was mine. I had a girlfriend, not my then wife, who knew that I wanted to be a novelist. I was less sure. And I had a friend, no longer a friend now, and he gave me a ticket to the London Book Fair and said, you should go along. You should go along and see what's what. And my girlfriend heard about this and said, you've always wanted to be a novelist. I said, that's what you say. I didn't say that. And she said, well, tonight you should write down that synopsis of that story you've always been going on about and take it to the London Book Fair, because if you want to be a published author, you have to get an agent. So I said, okay. So I wrote down my synopsis of what became my first novel on a sheet of A4, and it was getting late, so I didn't get to the second sheet of A4. I only had the one. And I went along to the London Book Fair, which was incredibly crowded, and I went up and down the aisles until I saw the word agent over a stand. And I hung about, not knowing quite what I was meant to say, until a short, quite tough-looking woman came out and said, what are you doing here? And I said, if there's any writers in the audience, this will make you blush as much as it does me. I said, I'm thinking of writing a novel. And she said, quite rightly, well, we're not here to talk to people who are thinking of writing a novel. We're here to sell the novels of the people we've already got on our books. So I said, oh, okay. But she was such an agent. She said, well, what do you got? And this was where the masterstroke came in. I said, I've only got one sheet of A4. And she said, one sheet of A4? And she said, I'll take it. Now, I'll explain that. The last thing an agent wants to do is read. That's the last thing they want to do. So one sheet of A4 was acceptable. Two might not have been so good. So I gave her the sheet of A4, and I walked down the corridor, and I was about to disappear into the morass of people who were swirling about, all the aspiring authors and the poets and the liggers and the diggers and whoever they were. And I was about to disappear into that, and there was a cry, a shout, and it was the agent. And she beckoned me back. She said, come back. I came back. She said, right, got your piece of paper. I said, good. She said, who are we? And I looked up. She said, no looking. I said, okay. I said, I don't know. She goes, no, you don't know, because I haven't given you my card. I said, no, you haven't given me your card. And she said, who are you? I said, well, I'm Lawrence Norfolk, I said, and all this. And she said, yes, that's very interesting, but that's nowhere written on this sheet of paper, nor is there a telephone number, nor is there an address. And then only many years later, we were sitting together, she's still my agent, she's been my agent for 25 years, and we were sitting together, and I said, you know something, if I'd taken one more step, I would have been lost in that crowd. You know, she's not the most mobile person, my agent. She wasn't going to catch up with me. I would have been in the crowd. I would have given her the sheet of paper. She would never have called. And that would have been it. I wouldn't be a writer. So if you want to be a writer, walk slowly.
Fantastic. Thank you so much. Lots of ideas, lots of anecdotes. Great ending to an amazing festival. Thank you all.
Great. Thank you. You've been great.
Thank you.